Welcome to episode 26 of the Venture Ventures D&D actual play, live play, campaign, D&D. I'm just putting words together randomly at this point. We are a bunch of comedians, improvisers, LARPers, and writers. And I would have preferred to say sleuth, like I had planned, but I didn't. It's just really hot here, guys. I've got all the windows closed, no fans on, I'm sweating bullets. Okay, let's go around the table and introduce yourself and your characters' stuff. Richard.
Hi, I'm Richard. I play Niolus Nymerith. He is a Triton sorcerer.
Dave.
Hey, I'm Dave Roderick. I play a Kenku warlock named Prodding Rod. Proddy for short.
Caw. Ryan.
Hi, I'm Ryan Omega. I play a human warlock named Orson Akers, a warlock pig farmer.
Brian.
Hi, I'm Brian. I play Crispin Crispy Oakenshaft, a human Kensei monk.
And Lex.
Hey, I'm Lex, and I play the most adorable Mousefolk spider named Ashwin.
You haven't been reminded of that in a while. I need to start doing that with NPCs.
Number one.
Okay.
Number one, adorable mouse folk. Let's all just remember that.
It's accurate.
Number one, adorable person in the party.
Before this goes
only
off,
right now.
Before this goes off the rails, let's get started. I'll do a recap real quick.
Accidentally spit on my laptop.
You spit on your laptop? I'm sorry.
They do those types of surgeries in Beverly Hills.
A recrap? Yeah. That's actually a legit scientific medical, if you think about it. With the
proper term is a colonic. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I was thinking of something else.
Oh, okay.
Previously on the Colonic channel, previously on Venture Ventures, the Big Bedfellows were making their way to Mostashar, which is a Shardmind floating tower to the south of the Viranal Dominion, and made their way into the mountain south, met some half-halflings who were constructed by some very famous artificers, and eventually made their way to a teleportation circle in the modeled mirror, which was an underground lake, which also happened to house a lot of conjured beings from other planes that a powerful magic user was summoning to perform experiments on. And that person that they were looking for took them to the teleportation circle, and they teleported to another part of the mountain range looking for the entrance to Mostashar. And when they arrived there was a bunch of people, crystal people called Shardmind, staring, guarding the entrance on that teleportation circle. And that's where we left off. They turned around and looked at you guys as you guys teleported in. And you think they're looking at you. And now that you're there, you look around and you see these little beast, reddish oranges, furred beasts that kind of look like koalas coming out of the walls as well. It almost seems like they were arriving about the same time you were, so the Shardmind are kind of overwhelmed with the amount of things they're seeing. There's three of them in front of you, and let's roll initiative.
Oh shit. Okay. Can I say hi?
You can use your action to do that, yes.
Just jump right in.
17.
7.
23.
Let's I'm gonna go from 25 to 20 like I normally do, and you sure. Just tell me where you land. 25 to 20.
23.
Ashwin, 25.
All right. Good job.
Starting strong.
20 to 15. 17. I keep getting someone's message, kind of notification in your microphone from Discord.
Okay, might be mine. Let me see if I could turn that off.
One sec, because these people rolled 16.
So did these koala things come out of like holes in the wall,
yeah,
or they're literally
in the wall,
like?
And
okay,
looking around, this is very similar to the other caves you've been in. Just maybe more of these crystals, and there's a tunnel behind the shard mine, the three shard mine that essentially you teleported in, and they had their backs to you as you teleported in, and they turned around, and there's a tunnel about 20 foot diameter that leads off behind them, and this teleportation room that you're in is the dead end to that tunnel, and there's tiny little holes in the wall that these koala things called Zorbos are crawling out of. So, okay, 15 to 10. Initiative, 15 to 10. 10 to 5.
6.
7.
Always one up in me.
All right. So, Ashwin, you have the three shard mine in front of you, and 1, 2, 3. You have 6 Zorbos, 3 on each side in the teleportation kind of end room that you're in. And what would you like to do?
Okay. So, I think Ashwin is going to get down on all fours and scurry all the way to the guards at front.
Okay.
And just be like, squeak, squeak.
Okay. Is that all you want to do?
I just want to see if they're, like, being threatening or not and see what happens. Like, if they're going to attack me, then I would probably attack back, but...
Right now, you see them essentially gearing up, rolling initiative. Yes, you think they look like they're taking, at the very least, a defensive position. So, yes, they're not turned around and just kind of, oh, hi. They're more like, what the fuck is happening? Why are these humanoids here and then these other koala type creatures are there? So if that gives you enough information,
no, then yeah,
you,
I'll just with
you
the,
could do something like ready or you
yeah
know.
You can hold your action essentially for if they attack or if they take an aggressive.
Yeah, I think yeah, that's what I'll do. So I just want to scurry over there, pretend like I'm just an oversized mouse, I guess.
Okay. And none of you
a rat, you mean?
Do not use the R word.
We're all learning things. Okay, so they say something. It sounds like a lot of harmonics. It's barely a language, but none of you speak Shardmind or Shard speak. So unless Ryan, I saw your eyebrows pop up. Do you speak shard speak, or do you have something
no.
that allows you to? Okay.
No.
I know there's an invocation that can do that, but all right. So you're holding your action until they are going to smack you. Crispy.
All right. Well, so these guards have crystals coming out of them, right, I believe?
They're all crystal. They're all...
Right.
Held together by some sort of energy. Yeah.
Perfect. So I sprint in the same direction as Ashwin, but I sail over her doing a jump kick. Heck, and then yeah. I try to whap it with my whip as well as I sail over it. So my two
Which
regular
ones? You
attacks.
Got one, two, and three from left to right.
Whichever one Ashwin went up to squeak at, because okay. I'm going over her head.
Ashwin, which one did you go up to squeak at?
The middle one.
Okay, two.
A foot's coming right at his face.
All right.
And it does not hit with a 10, I'm sure. Or a 9.
No, it doesn't. You kick it, and it just feels extremely hard, like you're hitting rock. But you're a monk, so you've done damage to rock before.
All right, so then my whip attack is a 12. Still pretty bad.
Nope. Dodges out of the way. And as you're flying past it, you can see that there are subtle gaps in between the shards of this creature that you can kind of see through. Yeah.
Gotcha. Not quite yet. I still have bonus action, so I'm going to try to... I'm going to go ahead and Flurry of Blows for two more unarmed. So that's a mod... Or sorry, not that's a 19.
Okay. Yep, that hits.
For one. And then the other one it hits. It's a 22.
Yep. You get angry and you start actually hitting these.
So things. I start actually hitting it. So that does 3-7 points of damage for the first one. And... I have 9 points of damage for the second one, and I'm going to Stunning Strike that last hit.
Do
so
it.
It's a Constitution save.
Okay. Natural 20.
Fails. Just kidding. It doesn't.
Oh.
Sorry, sir.
That's my turn.
When you Flurry of Blows, these are your fists and your feet, is that correct? How Flurry of
yes.
Blows? You feel your connections. You hit them before, but it was you didn't feel like it was doing anything. Now your hand kind of starts to break into some of these crystal shards and displace them in some way. And if you take a quick look at your fists and feet, there's a little bit of dust and crystal flakes on them. So, Niolus.
Okay, how wide are we? I'm picturing like we're on a bridge. Are we?
No, you're not on a bridge. You're just, so think of just a cavern with a normal underground stone and earthen floor.
And how far away are the creatures, the shard mine creatures?
Sure, they're 30 feet away.
30 feet away. And then
the width of the room, you cut out there. I think you're asking for the width.
Oh, yeah, the walls.
60 feet wide.
Okay, and we're in the middle-ish?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to cast Guardian of Faith.
Okay.
Which projects out, like, a gleaming, beautiful light, and you see a sword and a shield. And I'm going to move it 20 feet in front of me. Or not move it, but have it appear there. And basically, any hostile... being that gets within 10 feet of it has to make a dexterity save, and if they fail, they get 20 damage.
Okay. On their turn, correct?
On their turn.
Yeah, at the beginning of their
if
turn.
They move towards him, and I can keep him up to until he deals 60 damage.
Okay.
Towards Niolus?
Gets 10 feet within the guardian.
Oh, got it. Okay.
So yeah. If they start their turn there, they take damage, correct?
I think if they move into a space, so if they start it there, then they don't have to do it.
Okay. All right. Is that the action or,
yeah, that's my action. And then as a bonus action, I'm going to cast my spiritual weapon and, summon my trident.
Okay. And can you move that immediately or cast it next to them or,
I believe I cast it, I think it's 5 feet. Let me see.
I think you can cast it within 60.
Yeah,
feet.
It's with I cast it within 5 feet, and then as a bonus action, I can move it.
Okay. And it can move.
So I cast it within 5 feet of me.
Okay. And so it's within 5 feet of you. Currently, the guardians are 20 feet ahead of you and within 10.
Let's say 15.
Okay. So they're about halfway.
Yes.
Okay. Just a heads up, your casting range on that is actually 60 feet. So you can summon it anywhere within 60 feet of you, and then you can move it 20 feet as a bonus action. And you do get to attack with it when you summon it.
When I summon it? Really?
Mm-hmm. You cast the spell, you can make a melee spell attack.
What a good
I had to reread Spiritual Weapon like 500 times to get this right.
and it attacks a creature within 5 feet of the weapon. Okay, then I'll do that. I'll cast it near the one that was just attacked.
Okay.
And then I will slash at him. I think that's a melee spell attack. Okay, so I will roll. I got a 21.
Yes, that hits.
Okay, so 1d8. That's an 8 to hit.
Okay, roll a d12 for me.
Uh-oh. I got an 8.
Okay, and you said that was 8 damage?
Yes.
When your spiritual weapon hits this second shard mind, it pierces into it a lot further than you thought it would, and you think it did much more damage than than you thought.
So would I deduce that it is weak to magic?
You would deduce that from your experience with the crystal trolls and other things, that the crystals these things are made out of do weird things when they're hit with magic.
Okay.
In some way.
Okay.
And is that your turn?
Yes. Okay. I'll stay where I am.
All right. So it is the Zorbo's turn. And they're so ugly. I don't like them. So looking at them right now, there's a very strong similarity to the crystals on the shard mine and the crystals around this cave. And all of the Zorbos are on the side of the walls on crystals, and they have taken the similar hue to that of the crystals, which is kind of a rose, light red color. They're going to go after the shard mine. Three of them are going to go after the shard mine, and three of them are going to go after you guys.
Oh no.
Uh-oh.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, one of them's gonna go after you, Proddy. One of them's gonna go after you, Crispy, and one of them's gonna go after Orson. And the ones that have broken up from the side of the walls, you see they're, as they're coming towards you, their forms change as they hit the stone, and one of them goes over a long since dead, broken, large branch that somehow got underground. And it changes color really quick before it makes its way back onto the stone earth. And it's going to claw you.
Like camouflage?
You're not sure what's going on, but they're definitely something's changing based on where they are in contact with on the ground. Wow, just threw my dice off my dice tray. Okay.
Bye, dice.
Yeah. Okay. Crispy, that is a 15 to hit.
No, sir.
Okay. 12 to hit Orson.
That hits.
Yikes.
Gotta get that mage armor.
I knew. Oh, wait. This is a touch attack?
It's a claw attack, correct? Melee weapon attack, essentially.
As a reaction, I would like to use Hellish Rebuke.
Sure. What does your Hellish Rebuke look like?
Hellish Rebuke, one reaction, which you take response to being damaged by a creature within 60 feet of you. It is 5d10.
It's a dex save 13.
Dex save is 15.
Okay. It rolled a 16.
Oh.
I was more asking for flavor. Like how does Orson cast it?
When the claw attacks Orson, there's this light that comes out of Orson's eyes and just almost like very red, almost hugely demonic, looking back at the creature, like wanting to lash back at him. And it's a single finger just pointing straight at, like almost like shooting a gun.
Cool. And also, I will add that you also see, and Orson may or may not know this, it's up to you, Ryan, but you also see some very weird ears pop up from his head when he does it for an instance. And I need you took, I rolled for damage on that. That was 8 slashing damage, Orson.
Okay. All right.
And I need you to make a dexterity saving throw.
Dexterity saving throw. Oh. I believe I... 9.
Okay, that fails. One item, magic item in your possession, if you have any, is going to take some damage as it magically deteriorates from the animal strike. It's your choice what it is.
I'm going to lose my ring of truth telling.
Okay. And when it hits you, the ring just kind of instantly rusts and kind of turns into a dull crust encased remnant, and you see the Zorbo that attacked you kind of all of a sudden its skin looks like it just got a little bit thicker, and its fur gets a little bit thicker as well, and so that is its turn. One sec. Gotta do this accounting real quick. And Proddy, I haven't done... Okay. It's a 11 to hit Proddy as this Zorbos claws at you.
It's not hit.
So this thing is like...
Bing.
A little bit smaller than Ashwin as well. Some might say it's cute. I don't like koalas at all.
Get out of here.
So if you like koalas, then you think these things are cute too. All right.
Doesn't like koalas. Get out of here.
I'm really restraining myself from talking about my dislike of koalas. Okay. the other three Zorbos. Nope. Okay. Yep. You see the other three Zorbos swarm the other shard mine and try to claw at them, and only one of them hits on the third one. And you see, Orson, you see a similar effect occur from them, where the consistently colored shard mine of that red, where the Zorbo claws, it kind of loses some of its radiance, the color when it hits. And it, you see the Zorbo, who is a similar color, get a little bit brighter when it hits. For the love of God, I'm never going to get this song out of my head. All right. Shardmine's turn. Shardmine is going to respond in kind. The third Shardmine on the far right to that Zorbo.
That's a new version.
Fuck. It's fantastic. There we go. That's what I wanted. As this thing responds in kind, you see a spectral... You know it's arcane, those of you magic users, and non-magic users can essentially figure out pretty easily that... it's some sort of magic conjuration out of the arm of these shard mines that turns into a great axe as it looms over this Zorbo. Finally, get to use a D12. All right. No. So this shard mine responds back and slices this Zorbo diagonally in half, and it is no more. And then the middle one is looking pretty rough, very bloodied, but it's going to lash out at Crispy. All right, Crispy, that's going to be a 22 to hit.
Yes, that wow. Hits.
I only rolled a 3, but that's 7 slashing damage.
Okay.
And... Ashwin, I forgot that you were holding your action. Let's go ahead and resolve your... attack, because these things are aggressive. My apologies.
Well, let's see if my original plan is not going to work, so I will just attack the middle one, because he's in front of me.
They're definitely aggressive. You can attempt to still talk to them. I don't know if it... We'll see if it works.
I think fighting is definitely the option that's happening right now.
Okay. Just giving you the option.
It's fine. Yeah, I'll take out. So I'll try to take out the guy in front of me.
Okay.
Oof. 7.
No. Please. How does she? So she was on the ground on all fours, and how does explain how that?
I rolled a nat 1.
Oh.
Yeah.
Crispy, you're still within melee range, right?
I'm on. I jump kicked over the guy because I completely missed him, so I went to the other side of him.
Okay. Yeah, Zorbos, that's dead. Roll a d20, Ashwin. Okay. Nobody got hit by your errant. What did you use to attack there?
I was about to whip out the flame scimitar.
So that's what you were using, just it wasn't activated?
I was going to activate it, yeah. So
it was activated.
I haven't said the words, but yes, if I was going to hit, I would have yeah.
But you have to activate it before.
Yeah, I know. I realize it's really kind of backwards.
So let's just say it was on, correct?
Yeah.
Because you can't like, oh, I missed. Let me, you know, retroactively not use it.
My brain's not working right now.
I'm just trying to clarify what's going on. Okay, so you swing and miss. That's a bonus action to activate your flame tongue sword or scimitar?
Yeah, that was my 2 actions.
Okay. All right. That last shard mine. No. Nope. Not going to hit as the one on the left swings at you. It's not even close. It sees your swing and almost does as bad as you in terms of missing. Orson, it's your turn.
All right. So, from my vantage point, like, I still see 3 of the Zorbos and then, like, some other shard mines kind of in that area.
So you see there's 1 Zorbo on you, like, within melee, and there's 1 who is on Proddy, who's still in the teleportation circle. Area, and there's 1 that ran up to Crispy, and then the other 3 went in to attack, and one of them got you okay?
I'm fine. I just don't know how to drink water.
I've been there.
Ironic.
It is. Oh man, that's a good one. Yeah, and then the other 3, one of them just got taken out by the shard mine. So there's now 1, 2. There's 3 currently around the shard mine, and Crispy and Ashwin about 30 feet ahead of you.
Okay. So in that case, I'm just going to keep it simple, Eldritch Bolt to the one within melee range.
Okay, that's. Do you have Warcaster? It's going to be disadvantage on the attack.
Oh, I do not.
Okay, so disadvantage on your attack.
Why is it disadvantage?
Because you're within melee range. It's a weird.
Oh, role. You're attacking the Zorbo that just attacked you. Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, like he's kind of pissed and not rational right now. So. Oh, okay. Wow, okay, that is surprising. That is a 16 on disadvantage.
This one has... Yes, that hits. That just hits.
Wow. Okay. And that's for... Oh, well, that would be for 2 damage.
Okay. Um, Is it just the one bolt that you... Because I believe you have two, correct? Two...
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Okay.
So let me roll again.
Okay.
So the other one. And the other one is also two. So two beams of two damage each.
Okay.
So you don't have to do the charisma check on both bolts? On both blasts?
What do you mean charisma check? It's two separate ranged spell attacks? It's not a save. If that's what you're asking, Dave?
Yeah, I thought you cast Eldritch Blast with charisma.
You do, but you have to. It's a ranged spell attack. So there's two, when you're spell casting, there's two types of spell casting. There's the ones that are spell attacks similar to melee attacks, except they're magic. And then there's magic saves, which is where the person in control of the person being attacked has to roll a d20 and use their save modifier. Charisma is used in warlock spell casting. It's used with your spell attack.
Yeah, I was just asking because I only heard one die thing, so I was
yeah, there was, we only,
because I've the whole time I've been playing, I've been rolling the d20 twice, once for each Eldritch Blast.
Yeah, that's what you do, but he had disadvantage, and that's why I asked him if he had two.
Even still, he didn't roll the second attack.
I thought
he rolled one attack with disadvantage, hit with a 16, and then rolled damage a 2 twice for both beams.
Oh, did you second not beam, roll your second?
Prodi's right. No. The second beam would have a second.
Yeah,
attack.
Let me roll the other one. I'm sorry.
I assumed you were rolling.
I was about to be really happy that I wasn't going to have to roll the second.
Yeah, no.
D20.
I thought he rolled this
D20.
Wow,
are you?
Yeah, they can go to different targets, so they're different.
Oh my god. Attacks. So I rolled the second one, and that was a dirty 20.
Heck yeah.
I'm like, okay.
Do you want to use the damage that you already rolled? Okay.
Yeah, that's totally fine.
Okay. How did you tell that he wasn't rolling a d20?
Because he immediately said the damage without...
Oh.
Without
I
got it,
deciding
too.
If it hit or not.
You guys are perceptive. I just figured he did it. All right. It is now your turn, Sir Proddy of Doomerville.
I want to turn this Zorbo into a tiny raccoon, so I cast Polymorph.
Yes!
Do it. What's the save?
I believe it's a 13 for the Zorbo. Polymorph. Yeah, wisdom saving throw of 13. I'm guessing they don't have high wisdom. I don't know, not to make any judgment calls, but...
Wisdom is not their worst, but intelligence is their worst. I'll give you free information on that. That is a 15 save. As it...
Yeah, I fail. And then I'm gonna, as a bonus action, I'm gonna cast Hex on, I guess, whichever Shardmind is closest to Ashwin.
That would be the second one that is looking rough. It's got pieces of its what once comprised its body, its crystal body, on the floor, and it's barely holding itself together.
Okay, I'll put a hex on the one that hasn't been attacked yet then.
Okay, the one on the left.
So that's...
Wait, are there two or three?
There's three shard mines.
Okay, okay.
Back to the top of the round. Yes.
So what? Which ability are the Shardmind attacking with?
Which ability are they?
Because Hex lets me choose an ability that they have disadvantage on now.
They're swinging. You can't really tell.
I mean, so dexterity. I would just say they have disadvantage on dex. Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's just checks. It wouldn't affect their attack rolls. Regardless, but like if you put disadvantage on strength and someone tries to grapple them, they have disadvantage on that grapple because that uses strength.
To get out of the grapple, yeah.
It's a check, not a
ability check.
Modifier.
Hex their dex.
Yeah, dex sounds good to me.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Dex is hexed.
Usually a safe bet.
All right. At the top of the round, you see that one who just got hexed as it was its turn, it was reaching up for something around its neck, and something lights up in its chest, and the room starts to actually rotate on its axis. And the tunnel that was right behind him is no longer there as it rotated. It's just a more of the same wall, and you see a tunnel to your right right now. But it's
been... Did the wall rotate, so, or did we rotate on the floor?
The whole, like, imagine it as a encapsulated ball that you're in, I guess. So it has its own walls with holes in it, and then there seems to be an outer cave. So does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so yeah, it went like...
Okay.
And everyone make a dex save as the ground rumbles beneath your feet.
26.
19. Any of you who rolled less than 11, you're now prone. Everyone good?
Great.
I'm prone then.
I'm prone.
I use the momentum to do a backflip.
What a...
Just for funsies.
What a show off.
I use the momentum with, to put my hand on my hip.
With a 26, I mean, I have to.
As it's shaking, Niolus is just like, whoa.
Uh-huh, I'm like...
Perfect. We're back to the top. Ashwin, you're prone on the ground. It is your turn.
Great. What does that mean?
You're on your stomach or your back or your side. You're not on your feet.
Cool.
Are you asking mechanically or?
You can just get up.
Yeah, you use half your movement to get up.
Okay, cool. I'll just get up.
Or you can be an ankle biter and attack things with disadvantage.
Ashwin not impressed with being knocked down.
What the fuck, room?
Hey, it's just like that song, man. You get knocked down. Good to get.
Oh, no.
The cutest,
the one that I don't know the words to.
The cutest rendition, Ashwin the Mousefolk starts singing
Chumbawamba.
Chumbawamba, thank you.
I get knocked
down. Great, that's a great Saturday Day song.
But I get up again.
And you see Nihilus's spirit guardians start to, they take like an inch, they lurch forward when she starts singing, like,
no.
You didn't see it, but it was an imperceptible movement.
I'm going to attack the guy in front of me,
the most damaged one.
Yeah,
do it.
And I rolled a nat 20.
Heck yeah.
Ah, oh, nice.
Double those die.
Even though I have a plus, I was like, it's a nat 20. Yay.
At this stage, it doesn't matter.
Oh, and it's a 19. The other one.
So what's the total damage? 19?
No, that you made your second attack is a 19?
Yeah. Didn't you tell me, do I roll a D20?
No. You roll a D20 for your attack, and you roll the nat 20, then you roll your damage die, which for a scimitar is D6, I think.
Yeah, so that's a 3 and a 4. That's 7 plus 6.
13.
Yeah.
So the total damage for the first strike was what?
13.
And you doubled your dice, right?
Yeah, that's
rough. Okay.
I don't think that was right. So you rolled a 3.
Yes.
And then what was the second thing you rolled? That was a 4?
A 4.
What was that roll for? Is that the fire damage?
Yeah.
Okay, and then so it's 3 plus 7. You double that, so that's to 14. Now you add your plus.
Oh.
Exactly. You crit. That's what makes them so great. So it's a plus what? So you did 20 points of damage on the first strike.
Hell yeah, and you still got another attack.
There you go.
Nice.
You slice through it, and part of its arm is hanging by its crystal tendons. There's no tendon, but it's hanging by a thread of crystal.
Finish it.
Yeah. Just gonna finish it.
Have at it.
Hopefully.
Roll
Maybe
your
I'll miss.
D20.
It's
18. Yep.
Wow.
Maybe I'll do this right this time. How does the sword work again?
What does it say? Let me look at your character.
Pointy ends, business end, aimed at your enemy.
So, let me just look real quick. One second.
If it hurts, you're holding the wrong end.
That's what she said.
If it hurts more, it's because you're holding the wrong end and it's on fire.
Okay, so you rolled your d20 and you hit.
Yes.
And then it's 1d6.
Yeah.
And
so I rolled a 3.
And then you add, it's 1d6 plus 6, so it's 3 plus 6.
So that's 9.
9, correct. Slashing damage.
But it's also on fire.
Okay, so then we go to the notes. You see where it says plus 2d6 while flaming?
Yeah.
So then you roll that. And I don't think you rolled it for your crit.
You were missing 1d6 for your crit then.
That oh,
would get doubled. But that's beside the point.
It does 2d6 fire damage when it's a flame, an extra 2d6.
So I roll it twice.
So total, you roll 3d6 when it's on fire. 1d6 for the sword, 2d6 for the fire. Total 3d6. All right.
Okay, so that's it. So 9 for the fire part.
Describe how Ashwin slices through this thing as you finish it.
So you said it was hanging by a crystal tendon, apparently. I think I probably do a somersault in the air, cuts that off, and then impales it.
Fucking great description. And the shard mine next to it goes, oh, fuck. That's the cutest death I've ever seen, but you guys can't understand it because it's in shard speak. But Niolus, you shudder and you don't know why.
That tracks.
Anything else?
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like action surging.
Fuck yeah. Do it.
Let it ride.
So maybe this time I'll know how my sword works.
That's cool. You're learning.
No promises.
There really isn't. I'm cute because I'm stupid.
You said it.
Don't be hard on yourself. You just started playing D&D.
All right, so I rolled a dirty 20 to attack the next shard.
Yep. 3d6.
All right. 3 of them.
3d6s.
So, that's 4, a 4, and a 6. That's 8 plus 6. Actually, that's 8 plus 12.
That's 20.
20.
Which one were you attacking again? I'm sorry.
I was in the middle. So, number 3.
Okay. Number 3, it's your lucky day. Okay. It's bloodied. It's crystal bloodied. And you have another attack.
Yeah, I was like, I think I have one more.
You do. Welcome to Fighterville, Population Ashwin.
I only have one job in this group, you guys.
Smash.
Be cute.
And smash the shit out of things.
So I rolled a 19. I'm not going to add it because I'm pretty sure I hit.
Yes. Wait, you rolled a 19?
Yeah.
That's a
that
crit.
That crits for you.
Yeah.
Because you're a champion. Jesus Christ.
So now 3d6, double it, then add your modifier. That's how it works.
Okay.
Crispy, 3d6. You're like the surgical knife of this group, and Ashwin, the tiny, tiny mouse folk, is the fucking sledgehammer.
I don't like that one. Nine. 13.
So, are we doubling that?
Can't be doubles.
What were your rolls?
My rolls was 13.
So 26.
So 13 doubled to 26.
Yeah.
And then you add your plus whatever to it.
The plus 6.
All right, so 32 points of damage.
Please describe how you'd like to destroy this other one. Jesus Christ.
Okay, so Ashwin impales the other one, looks to the other guy, brings her things up, does a flip, and just impales the other one next to her.
I just got the chills. That's how good that round was. And Crispy,
that's a flame tongue in the hands of a fighter right there.
Yeah, and Crispy, you just did a backflip when the room rotated, and then you saw this. You're feeling pretty good.
Don't push Ashwin down on the floor.
Mm-hmm. Fucking room! I think that's your turn, is that correct?
Yes, I am now done.
Okay. Niolus.
Crispin is after.
Oh, you're correct.
Well, I certainly feel like I have something to prove. so I'm going to first I'll whip the Zorbo that tried to attack me and missed.
Yep.
My whip is not doing it today. That's a 9. Probably not going to do it.
Nope.
Okay. Now I'm going to try and hacky sack it up with my foot. Better. That's a 19.
Yep.
That does 9 points of damage.
Heck yeah.
As I pop it up with my foot into the air up to shoulder height. then I try to punch it.
It makes that hideous noise koalas make, the
yeah, that was a hideous noise.
Serenading noise.
No.
And that is a 16 to hit on the punch.
Yep. Just hit.
And that is another 9 points of damage.
Describe how you kill it.
Oh, sweet. So I hacky sack pop it up and punch it. And when I punch it, it goes flying like 15 feet against the wall.
Heck
and
yeah.
Slaps against the wall and drops down on the ground.
When he kicks it, you hear...
Sounds like a deflating balloon.
It was like setting it up. It was like a volleyball set. You know, I just like popped it up in the air for myself. All right, here we go. There we go. And that'll be my turn.
Okay, fantastic. Niolus.
Okay, Niolus is going to move about 10 feet towards his guardian. And so he'll be within 5 feet of it. And he's going to change tactics and start attacking one of the Zorbos because it seems like they're fucking shit up. And I don't like that. So I am going to cast... There are two Zorbos next to the Shardmind mine, right?
Yeah, there's 1, 2, 3. There's two left, correct, I think. Let me just make sure.
Okay, and then behind him, there's 3.
Back on the teleportation circle, there's 2. Yes.
Oh.
There's 2, and then there's 2. 2 have been killed, and there's 2 ahead of you around where that crazy shit just happened. So, near your spiritual weapon. Does that make sense?
Two near... Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so I move. I'm closer to the guy or to the spirit thing. And then I'm going to cast Magic Missile. And I think I want to do a level 2 Magic Missile, which I think gives me 4 darts. And I'm going to do 2 and 2 to the 2 Zorbos that are next to the mine, the Shard Mind.
Okay.
And so I do 1d4 per... Get my d4s. Okay, so that's... Okay, so I'm going to send 7 damage to one.
Mm-hmm.
And I will send 6 damage to the other.
Done.
And then I'm going to swing my spiritual weapon at the one that had dealt the more damage to.
Okay, fantastic.
And that's a 16. Does that hit?
We need to have you roll the d12 for those magic attacks. I'm sorry.
A d12. Okay.
So roll 2d12, one for each Zorbo that you hit.
For the magic missile?
Yeah. So 1d12 okay. For one Zorbo and 1d12 for the other.
I got a 10. For the one with the 7 damage.
Yep.
And an 11 for the 6 damage.
Okay. So the one with the 7 damage, it's a lot. It seems like it was affected, just not any more or any less than you would think. Mm-hmm. And the second one hits it, and the Zorbo, because it had an encounter with the crystal, the shard mine. It's going to take. All right. So one damage is reflected back at you.
Oh, no.
Arcane damage.
Okay, so I'll take the one damage. And then, yeah, so now I'm going to swing my. Virtual weapon at the one that seemed to be affected more.
Okay.
So the one that took 6 damage, and so that was a 16 that I had rolled.
Yep.
Okay, cool. So then I roll a d8. Oh, okay, that's only going to hit 2.
Okay.
And that'll be my turn.
Okay, cool. Fantastic.
Okay.
And let me just mark that. Zorbo's turn. Zorbos are going to retreat. And those of you who are within melee, which is Orson, Proddy, Crispy, I think is, and anyone else? No.
Ashwin, probably.
Yeah, I was like, what?
She went after. Yeah, sure. Yeah. Go ahead, Ashwin. Attack of opportunity if you like.
Oh, yeah.
13.
Thirteen does not hit. 18 does hit. Proddy and Orson, if you want an attack of opportunity, you can.
Am I still going to be at disadvantage if I use Eldritch Blast again, or no?
I don't recall if you can use, unless you have Warcaster.
Yeah, I don't.
That is correct. You need Warcaster.
You need Warcaster to cast a spell with a reaction. But if okay. you can hit it with something, like a stick.
I do have a sickle, so I'll just hit it with a sickle.
Cool. Ashwin, what was the damage?
Okay.
I do not hit.
Okay.
19.
Jesus Christ.
Wow.
You smash through it. Another dead Zorbo.
Bye-bye.
Dave.
Proddy gets, he stands up because he was prone, and he just like whips out his two daggers, and he just like tries to stab him. He misses him with one dagger because he rolled a nat one, and then he rolled a 22 with the other one.
So you only get one stabs, attack on your attack back. Of opportunity.
So oh, okay. Then forget about that second dagger. He just like tries to slash it as he's running away, and he misses.
Okay, perfect. You hear the Zorbos letting out a kind of piggish koala sound, and they're all retreating away into their holes in the ceiling. And their holes that they came from are in different spots, but they seem to know exactly where to go in the walls. And they're tiny, like this big. They somehow squeeze through it. Zorbos are gone. And the one Shardmind is going to grasp its chest again and try to initiate what you saw earlier. And then it's going to try to run out of there. So, Ashwin, you already used your reaction. Crispy already used your reaction. And that's it. It runs out of the room into a new hall that you have no idea where it goes. Then it is Orson's turn.
Okay,
it's about like 30 feet away.
About 30 feet away.
Yeah.
Go back to my Eldritch Blast.
Okay. All
right. So
1 first D20. One. Yep.
First one is a 14.
No.
No. Okay. Second one is less than a 14. So no.
Okay. Two, what color were your Eldritch Blasts again?
They're blue.
Okay. And your arcane focus is what?
My arcane focus.
Like, what do you use to cast? I'm just trying to think of a way to describe this.
Oh, okay. My arcane focus is a,
crystal?
Oh, what is it? Crystal, yes.
So, Orson grabs his crystal and two blue bolts of force magic energy shoot out towards the escaping shard mine or retreating shard mine and miss. Okay. There's nothing else, Proddy. It's your turn.
Proddy, not to be outdone by Orson, just puts his dagger away and he gets out his rod and he's going to do Eldritch Blast. And you see just black, like, crackling energy go towards the Shardmind person.
Fantastic.
And he rolls a 10 for the first beam, and he rolled a nat 20 for the second one.
Hell yeah, the 10 doesn't hit.
I rolled the damage, and it's a 12 damage for the second one.
Doubled? Or is that...
Oh, right, I forgot to double it. Yeah, 24.
Wow. Yeah.
Yay!
As this thing is escaping into the less lit area down the cave, you see shadows sparkle as pieces of these crystals shoot off the back of this thing. Okay. And as this thing is stepping towards the end, entering the hallway, the room starts to rotate again, and everyone make your deck save.
Oh.
Crispy, you hit the ground. And
I tried to do another backflip.
You tried to do another backflip, you take 2 damage as you hit your head on a rock on the floor.
That's fair.
Nailed it.
What'd you get, Ashwin?
A 10.
Yep, you hit the ground again.
Damn it!
Who else?
I got as well.
I also fall down.
All of you fall. How unfortunate. The only one who made the save was a shard mine. As the room rotates, it starts to close on that tunnel that it was escaping to, sealing the way to follow it, and it makes it through the threshold right before it's sealed off, and the room is rotated, revealing another tunnel going a different direction that you haven't seen yet. All of these tunnels, by the way, are just same size, same looking, very dark. You're out of initiative.
Shoot, I didn't want to let that guy get away. And I start rummaging around the other shard mine corpses to see if were they grabbing like a physical object in their chest to rotate the room?
The only one who was grabbing their chest was the one that escaped.
Gotcha. Well, I'm still checking the other ones to see if they have anything.
Make an investigation check.
19 with my awesome plus 0.
You're pretty sure you're looking pretty freaking well, especially now that you're on the ground looking at it at ground level.
yeah, crawl over to it.
Yeah, you hit your head and then you try to play it off as like, oh, I just got to look closer. That's why I'm down here. you're not finding anything. You find similar crystals to what you found when you fought the crystal troll. They're a lot duller than what you saw when the thing was alive. You don't think they're worth anything, but...
Yeah.
Who knows?
Can Proddy go over to where the Zorbos, the holes that they were going into, and do an investigation check?
They're different holes now because the room rotated again. So,
got it.
Does that make sense?
I thought it was just the door.
No. The Zorbos, when they escaped, it was before it had rotated. It was still after the first rotation, but they seemed to know exactly which hole to go into, even with the room rotated. But you can investigate. Go ahead and roll an investigation.
Investigation 9.
Yeah, I mean, they're tiny holes, and on some of them you can see that they dead end. And
you're not... Hey guys, there's some tiny holes over here.
Can I fit in it?
It's pretty small. I don't know. Depends on, like, how much you want to squeeze yourself.
Are you calling me fat?
do your people have bones? Because if you don't have bones, I think you could probably squeeze through. But if you have bones, I think it might be trouble. And they're only about this big. You know, like an octopus.
Tiny holes.
Like an octopus.
Niolus, do you have bones?
Are
that... Is it Niolus? Do you have bones?
Oh, I wasn't sure if you said the name or not.
I thought it was like a really great like ignoring.
Oh, okay. Niolus says, "Oh, I've come across some bones in my life."
Can any of you talk to animals other than me?
I think I might be able to.
No, I don't think you should call yourself an animal. That's not very nice to yourself.
No, I have an idea. Because I'm mad and I want to go after them. Or at least get out, go through these holes.
God, Orson, I've never seen you this mad before.
Well, his eyes start getting red. It's like,
I can only talk to animals in the sea, sorry.
What's got you so upset, Orson? The Zorbos or the shard mine?
All of it. I couldn't even really hit them. but I have an idea. And then so what Orson does is he looks how big he goes over to one of the holes. How big in diameter is the hole?
20 feet.
The diameter?
Of the big hallway or the Zorbo hole?
Zorbo hole.
Oh, yeah. I thought you were talking about the new tunnel. The Zorbo holes are like this big.
Okay, so we're looking at about a foot.
Oh, they were that small attacking us? Okay.
Yeah, okay.
That's why Crispy was able to pump them.
Okay. So I look at everyone here. It's like, so who can talk to me if I turn into something else?
Turn into a fish.
I could talk to you if you turn into a small beast.
Or you could, oh, turn into a crab.
Can I turn into a snake?
I can't understand. Yeah, I can talk to you. You're a snake.
I like how he asked and then like just was.
Was it a water snake?
A what?
Because then Niolus could talk to you.
Fine. I will try to.
Do you mean eel? What is a water snake?
Oh, water snake.
A water snake.
Do they breathe underwater, though?
Yeah, yes. They can.
Oh.
They can hold their breaths for incredibly long.
Oh, well, but it can't breathe underwater.
Oh, can you only talk to creatures that can breathe underwater?
Yes.
So, like, dolphins you can't talk to?
I guess not.
I think you can. I don't know.
Oh, I can. Can I turn into a frog?
Yeah.
You can talk to me then.
Simple ideas with beasts that can breathe underwater.
Interesting. So yeah, you can't talk to dolphins.
Turn into a lobster.
I don't want to turn into a lobster and crawl into one of these things.
Then I can't help you.
Tell me what you can talk to. Can you talk to a crab?
A frog? Sure.
Fine.
Yeah, and I can just talk to smaller beasts. So you're fine.
So
okay.
Turn into an axolotl. An axolotl.
What? I don't know what that is.
They're so cute.
They're adorable. Okay,
they're fine. If it makes me if it makes me cuter than Ashwin, then I'll do it.
Oh, it will.
So
it will.
What is an axolotl?
It's like a little salamander-looking thing, except it's way cuter than a salamander.
Does it have like a fish
it looks kind of like a water dragon.
Yeah.
All right.
They can crawl on land.
Okay. So
I believe.
So I go to one of these
holes,
these turbo holes, and then I turn into an axolotl. I know what it is out of character. I don't know what it is in character.
Jake
so...
doesn't know. Jake's looking it up.
Oh, it's axolotl.
Axolotl. It's cute. So I turn into what I think an axolotl is.
Oh, okay.
Which is
yeah.
Yeah.
Oh no.
Yeah. Okay, you're an axolotl.
All right. So I turn into this cute thing, and then I try to proceed through the Zorbo hole to try to get to the other end of it.
You go down this hole and without issue. It goes pretty damn far. It's been like 10 minutes, and you guys, hasn't returned. You're still looking for the end of this tunnel. Orson, do you want to keep going?
Yep.
He's dead. We need to get out of this rotating room.
Okay. So
I'm going to try to communicate with him. And say, we're leaving now.
What's the distance on your communication?
It doesn't say.
Okay. His movement isn't, like, it's not 30 feet like it was now that he's a axolotl.
Do I feel like I'm getting anywhere close?
It's just, what do you mean by close? It's just continuing on and going, diving down and up. It you haven't reached the end of it yet, but like if you're, what do you want to do? Like, or what do you want to ask me? Let me know.
Oh, okay. Okay. So my intention of going through the Zorbo hole is to try to see if I can get to the end of it and then find where the Zorbo, like where that Zorbo was coming from.
Sure,
and
you can,
if I could find the Zorbo.
You can definitely look, keep looking, but you haven't mm-hmm. reached the end of it yet. If you want to go for another 10 minutes, let me know. You did hear Niolus sometime towards the end of the 10 minutes. You heard in your head, like, we're going to leave now.
Okay.
It was more like, okay, we're leaving now.
Okay.
At that point, Orson doesn't think it's worth it. So he starts coming back.
Okay.
The way he came.
So, and he can communicate to you, correct, Niolus?
I can kind of like understand his emotions type of thing.
Or
like,
polymorph,
like his intent.
You keep your thoughts, right? Like you're not as stupid as an axolotl. No, you don't?
You are as stupid. You retain your personality is how it words it. So you know friend from foe, but you do actually change your mental stats as well.
That's rough.
Oh, well, in that case, I still come back because I still mm-hmm. am intent on survival.
Sure.
More than anything, more than anything else.
And you know they're your friends, so yeah.
Right.
So yeah, 10 minutes later, you arrive back into the room, and...
Do we have to smack him?
I just had to roll real quick. You can if you can attempt to if you want.
I mean, well, because he has to turn back, right?
Mm-hmm.
Niles is gonna do one of these.
Make an attack roll.
I mean he has to turn back, right?
You just have to do one. We're gonna assume that this type of creature only has like one hit point.
Yeah,
so.
If he hits. It's gonna knock him out, but
and the problem is, I think if I'm that dumb, I'm gonna try to avoid.
Yeah, no, you're definitely.
Oh yeah.
An unarmed strike is +3. I got 20.
Oh yeah,
30, 20.
I was about to look up a similar beast, like a lizard or something, but yeah, that hits.
No.
You hit, and as your back, the back of your hand connects with this tiny, tiny axolotl. you're like, oh, it's kind of slimy, and then all of a sudden a lot more mass connects with your hand as the one hit point is transferred to the axolotl, which poofs him out, and roll a unarmed. What's your unarmed? What's your strength?
It's just one plus strength, but I don't have strength, so
okay,
it's just
so
one.
One, and you don't do any more damage to Mr. Orson.
And then I say, welcome back.
Oh, no. And by the way, when he's been getting, when he got angry as the probably the most angry you guys have seen him, is that correct, Orson?
Or, yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. You saw like a faint hint of those ears, those pointy mammalian ears. And I want Proddy and Niolus to make a intelligence check, general intelligence check. So roll the d20, whatever number that is, add your intelligence modifier.
10.
Which is at the top of your page. Dave, are you good?
Yeah, it's 15.
Okay, yeah. Good to know. That's the extent of that. And
we can't even question him about it.
Oh, you can question. You can absolutely verbally like, yeah. Sure.
Okay, Niolus is gonna kind of like slowly like walk up to him and like put a hand on his arm and say, "Hey, what was that? What happened there? What with the ear? What happened?"
I was just something else. I was just an axolotl.
But axolotls don't have those ears.
I would stop talking if I were you.
Okay. I'm going to walk up to my spiritual guardian, my guardian of faith.
Were you keeping concentration on it the whole time? Or,
I would say so.
How long
I mean,
does it last?
He was just there 8 hours.
Oh, Jesus. That's a fantastic spell. Cool. Go ahead.
That's it. and just go into the comfort of its warmth.
Do they follow you, or do they stay on the ground?
No, I think it just stays there, so I'll have to, like, dismiss them.
Oh, okay.
Well, I've been standing near the opening down the hallway looking nervously about. All right, guys, I think we should get out of here. With one of them getting away, I don't want to tarry any longer.
It's been 10 minutes.
it's been 20 minutes. 20, we had to wait for him to come back.
Oh, okay. Oh, right, because he had to come back.
Yeah.
And it's different...
the whole time I was nervously pacing.
And it's a different hallway, tunnel. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Hey, guys. I got a stupid question. Maybe because I've just been hit one too many times. But where's Iris?
That is not a stupid question.
That is a very good point. And we start looking around. Is she not with us?
Nope.
That fake bitch.
Nope.
Huh. Well, maybe there's a problem with constructs and teleportation circles. I don't know a thing about them.
Proddy gets out his map mimic and looks at it.
So when you look at it, it's, you know, a wide view of the continent. And the dot is still in the same spot because it's such a wide view. You're not getting a
zoom in. Zoom in.
The mimic licks your face, and it's a very sticky. Make a. Oh, do you do that?
Yeah.
It's stuck to your face unless you want to. You can try to remove it.
I can try to remove it from my face. Yeah, I think I'd have to do that eventually.
It's like right here.
Oh, you're so cute. I try to like get it off.
And you feel it's very, very needle-like, sharp needle-like teeth, but it's not like. It's like happy. It. There's a sense of kinship.
They're love nibbles.
Yeah, great. Exactly.
He's well fed right now. So do I have to roll anything to get them off my face?
Or? I just want to check their stat real quick.
That's beautiful. It
Make
has
a
stat.
Strength check. Athletics check. I guess it would just be enough.
10.
No. We'll say you try for another 10 minutes, and then you will give it another shot. Go ahead. And.
Okay. If he's struggling for 10 minutes, by then I would have walked over to try and help him.
Okay, go ahead. Crispy, strength, athletics.
I rolled lower, so.
Niolus just, like, sits down cross-legged and, like, watches.
7.
20 minutes passed.
Can we walk and do this?
We need to get out of here. What are we doing?
Can I try?
I rolled an 18. 20 minutes, I rolled 18.
So, like, we'll say at, like, 21 minutes, you were able to. And when pull it
back
off.
Back in the old cloak. Oh.
You pull it off, and you're looking at it, and it's, like, got its tongue out to the side. And just looking at it.
Yeah, did that taste good? Did that taste good? Oh, back in the cloak.
Perfect. Perfect. So we learned something about mimics and their ability to be sticky. So what do you guys want to do now after?
I don't know if you guys are suspecting that I swear to God, I didn't do anything to Iris. I think she didn't come through the teleporter with us. So
Niolus suggests a picnic.
Maybe she hung back because someone's trying to kill her. And she saw a way out. All right, let's get out of this room. There's no reason to stay here, I don't think.
Okay.
So no picnic? Okay. I'm going to wrap up my blanket that I set down.
You realize, like, enemy corpses. No, they're just crystals, but they're, like, they're all over here.
It's been 40
there's a
minutes.
Sneer from a Zorbo. Still, like, a gross blood smear down one wall. Yeah, no, let's leave.
And
I'll take point.
What light source are you guys using?
Oh, it's
I can
dark
cast
in
dancing
here.
Light.
Okay.
I have my flame sword.
How long?
I have my elven dagger with lights with the light spell on it.
By the way, that's not a permanent. That dagger you bought from Obadiah Semple. That's a. I was going through your guys' character sheets a few weeks ago. and that's a one-use item because it's a bauble. It's a remnant of the erasure. When magic was imbued into mundane items, the broken dagger, so it can cast light once, and then it becomes just a broken dagger.
A broken dagger.
Okay. Well, then I'm gonna use it. I'm gonna use it now because we want to get out.
So Orson is leading the way at the front of the group. What's the marching order after that?
I'll be behind him. I'm antsy to leave.
I'm on his shoulders, as always.
I'll be behind them.
I'll be behind Niolus.
Iris will be behind you. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. So do you guys, I'm curious, just, this is Jake, the DM, asking, what is your goals here? Have you guys talked about that? Or if you've talked about it, please tell me.
Well, our goal right now was trying to find our way into Mostashar to get a feel for the situation and the Shard Mines setup. I have my reasons.
And you guys,
Crispin, what are your reasons for wanting to go to Mostashar? I mean, I know we basically had two foes and just picked the lesser of two evils because we were creeped out by the acting company. But is there something specific you want out of Mostashar?
Oh, I'm very happy that you're all creeped out by the acting company. They were terrible actors. That actually had no bearing on my personal decision on which one to go at. I came up here to the Virinal Dominion. I met up with you just to basically get in here because I'm trying to track down Fordak Kems. I didn't know what it was, what he is when I came here. I've just been I was given that name. I had to beat it out of someone really hard.
Why? What are you looking for this guy for? What what is happening here?
Looking for an old friend, I guess you could say.
An old lover? Wink.
No, never was. Never was an old lover. He was an old friend. And
is Fordak Kim your friend?
No. I'm looking for a dwarf. I expect he's going to be around here, though. They seem to have a relation. You ever heard of Kems? Just Kems.
No.
Any of you?
No.
I'm assuming he looks something like this, and I pull aside my shirt and show you. You've seen it before, as we all sleep in the same bed. and it's a tattoo of a head, of a horned head, with pretty distinct... I believe they're serpentine eyes, if I remember correctly, from the image you sent me, Jake.
Oh.
So, I don't know much about him, to be perfectly honest. My knowledge is more like secondhand. No, this is, I guess you could say it's my friend's god, and I'm guessing the deity that Fordak Kems also follows. Let's just say there's some special kind of evil.
Did they put that mark on you?
Yeah, my friend did it. I mean, I was voluntary at the time, but I didn't really know.
Were you
didn't
drunk
really know or... much about it. No, I was young. Is what it was.
So we all make dumb mistakes.
Why is your friend mixed up with the Shard Mind?
He was raised in a monastery, and he was with the Brotherhood of Kems. There's disciples of Kems. There's one of them, I guess. Didn't really know much of what they were about. He was the only child among them, so he was a buddy of mine. But turns out they're real shitty. There's no other way to say it, really.
Was that your monastery?
No. I was just raised by my dad and my stepmom nearby.
So you became a monk at a different monastery.
He taught me what he knew. I'm not so much a monk. I'm a second-hand monk. I can fight like him, but that's about the extent of what I know. I don't follow a particular set of beliefs other than don't be shitty.
Me too. I try not to be shitty with people.
That is a lie. I died. Not a particularly insightful person, but I don't believe you. So yeah, that's I'm. He taught me, my friend. He taught me what he knew. So that's where I know. That's how I learned what I know, and anything else I've just picked up from there. But that's what I'm looking for. So when I've connected 4.chems with a shard mind, well, that's what I'm trying to topple.
So those of you who had the encounter with the gas spores and were poisoned and had a disease that Girasol cured, all of you had those, what feel like your own memory, except you were hearing the voice of a deep, just deep growly, similar to what you heard from some of the beholders during the play. And you know, because some of you saw it in a reflection or in the memory you had when you were diseased, he referred to himself as that, what he described. So you know that that is a beholder.
Right.
Just telling.
I know that now.
Yeah, yeah. I'm just.
But I didn't know that before.
Right.
It's just a name I pulled out of an old dying man's lips.
Richard, your face is perfect there. I just imagine Niolus just kind of. Okay. Perfect. Thank you guys for doing that conversation. I love that shit. I live for it. Okay, so you're heading down the hallway and it is pitch dark. You would think it would be completely dark if you didn't have your various tools to do it. The light spell lasts 1 hour, Orson, I believe?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so are you stealthing or are you just like, hi-ho, hi-ho, we're off, whatever
pretty
we go.
Pretty much hi-ho. Yeah, pretty much hi-ho.
So none of you are stealthing?
I am, though I have a mouse on my shoulders.
I'm stealthing.
We need stealth.
Yeah, we're going
probably
stealth,
stealth for like the first 5 minutes and then was like, this is pointless.
Okay, so Orson... Those of you who aren't stealthing, or those of you who are stealthing, please give me your stealth roll.
10.
23.
Ooh. Just two of you stealthing?
25.
Nice. So the Ashwin crispy
combo.
I just feel like
extremely stealthy.
All Ashwin had to do to stealth because she's sitting on your shoulder is just be quiet.
But she's doing an awesome job at it.
Do you guys just think I'm extra hair on his head?
Yeah, like,
exactly.
Usually crispy when she does that, you get tickled by the whiskers. But now she's like, you think like maybe she realized that.
Did she jump off?
Yeah. Maybe she... I don't even feel her now. I don't feel the whiskers, which usually tickle my ear every once in a while when she's looking around, but maybe she realized that her whiskers were tickling me. So you continue down this tunnel. And...
with Mickey Mouse ears.
Yeah.
They're just popped up.
Yep. Make a perception check, everyone. You go for about... 40 minutes and it's just continuing down, up, but you're not seeing any other off branching tunnels.
18. 10. 18. 9. 16.
Okay. Good to know. Continuing on for probably another 30 minutes. Oh, yeah. Light spell goes out. Do you put up your dancing lights when that happens, Richard?
I mean, it only lasts for a minute.
Oh.
But it's a cantrip.
I'm sure. It's a cantrip. I could keep casting it.
Yeah. So I'm assuming...
They're blue and green.
Thank you. Do you go up to the front, or do you just stay where you were at and throw them?
No, I'm going to stay where I'm at, because I can cast them away from me.
You can... Can't you turn them into, like, a vaguely humanoid shape if you put all the lights together? Would you do that, or would you separate them?
Yeah, sure, I'll do that. It's a human. Well, not a human, but it's humanoid, and it's walking with us.
Cool. Perfect. And it sheds light in 60, 30 and 60, or remind me of that?
10-foot radius. And then I can move it 60 feet.
Okay.
If I want.
Okay. Perfect. So, 20 more minutes, and you get to a part. It's not quite as big as the teleportation room, but it's slightly larger, maybe 30 feet in diameter, of a kind of like a pivot point, or just a room where there's three tunnels now instead of one. And one of them is, the right one is probably the smallest. I'd say it's about 10 feet in diameter. And then the from right to left, they're slightly larger in diameter. You have tunnels to choose from if you'd like to do any sort of investigations or ask questions. Let me know, because they look
like... Do any of them smell different?
One of them... That's a fantastic question. One of them smells like feces and essentially just decay and rot, the left one. And the middle one and the right one doesn't smell too different from each other. But you can make a perception check if you want to discern...
Could I investigate to see if there are, like, footprints from the mine shard that we would see going in any one of them?
You can. You can still do this, but just to remind you, it went in a different tunnel because it was rotating, remember?
Oh, right. And well, then I guess to see if there is, like,
tracks,
if it looks like anything was...
Perception, you said, for the smells? I learned, I read about an old wizard once. His best piece of advice is, when in doubt, follow your nose. An old wizard named Gandalf. It was 13 perception.
You're damn sure that Bilbo is down this hallway. No, I'm kidding.
I only read about him.
What'd you get?
14.
14.
For investigation.
Yeah. You see that the middle passage, the larger... the one that's slightly larger than the one on the right, has some, how to describe this? Like something was slithering, possibly, you don't know when, but you see some marks of possible slithering down the middle tunnel, and, Crispy, your smell doesn't give you much other than that. One is a lot more moist, I guess. There's a lot more humidity. Not a lot more, but a little bit more, you think, in the center tunnel than the right tunnel.
Gotcha. Well, I tell them, like, well, we're ruling out that one because it smells terrible. So definitely not that one. I think this smallest one is probably our best bet. Seems the driest, least smelly.
Niolus?
Okay.
Any other one?
Niolus gets down on all fours and skitters to the to the center to the center hole and says, you guys, I see some, like, track marks here. Do we not want to follow this?
It's about that time, Niolus. Your bag. Where do you keep your your device.
I guess just in a bag next to me.
Do you keep it like on your person? Like, so you can feel it?
Like wearing it? No, it's probably in my bag.
Okay. So yeah, you feel a humming. It's a hum that you've heard before and you've been trained to realize. And you pull out the object. What does it look like?
It's like a circle, kind of like a pendant type of circle. It's silver and it's got like intricate markings weaving in and out throughout it. And, there's like little blue in it.
Okay. And it is glowing in the way it was described that it would glow to you. And, yeah, it's basically doing exactly what it's intended to do when it's activated.
Okay. So I hold it out, and Niolus kind of sighs, and he says, okay, so guys, this means something, and it's not good. Something's happening in my village, and I'm being summoned back. So
What's happening?
I have to leave you guys because I'm being summoned back to the village and I have to go back. Something happened to our general and I need to go figure out what the next step is for us.
I look around in this like cave-like room where go, that sounds fine, but
I think I'm gonna head back towards the tunnel and wait for the room to rotate and go back to the teleporting disc.
Yeah, you can get back because that device you have when it's activated and you've been taught how to make it interact with the teleportation circle, because typically you have to know that spell to make a teleportation circle work. But you were trained in how to make it work with a teleportation circle, as long as the circle hasn't been warded against. If it's like a general teleportation circle, then you can definitely use it. So yeah, you definitely think you need to go back to that circle and use the device. What are we calling it? Just a amulet?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and hopefully you think it should work on teleporting you back to your home.
Mm-hmm. And then he'll say, I would ask you all to come on this journey with me. However, this is underwater, so I do have to make this journey on my own.
Yeah, I'm afraid that would kill me.
I could only last or until you smack me.
Proddy just says it's been really nice adventuring with you, and I also can't go underwater, and I respect that you're going back home to take care of things with your people, and safe travels.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Make sure you announce yourself as you walk up, because keep in mind you look a bit like a nightmare. So,
you know what? That's going to be fine for me because I want everyone to fear my wrath.
Well, just make sure your own people don't start shooting at you when you walk up.
I'm sure I'll have a cloak on, and they'll feed me by my sexy body anyway. It's fine.
Yeah. Sure. Yep.
I hope that works. Best of luck to you.
Thank you. I'll miss some of you and hate some of you, but mostly because there have been false rumors about one of you being more adorable than me.
Wait, yes. Before you go.
Yes, Ashwin.
Well, you seem kind of sad This seems like a very urgent thing, so I want to just give you something, because I feel like you could use it. And she rummages in her bag, and she pulls out a blowgun and gives it to you.
A blowgun?
Yes.
Okay.
All right.
Oh, thank you, Ashwin.
Are they like special underwater darts or something?
No, he just could use, like, he could use another weapon other than magic.
Oh, well, thank you. I'll replace my crossbow with it.
I wouldn't do that. Just keep it extra.
Oh, okay. Niolus gets a little teary-eyed as he to walk away and say goodbye to his friends.
Even knowing that a blowgun, a blow dart is pretty much useless underwater, mm-hmm. the sentimentality of it is awesome. So Niolus walks back from the cave, taking his dancing lights with him. As you see the light kind of fade out, it goes down this winding path, and you're getting glimpses of the glow until it goes into the dark.
And you do hear a distant echo of a wailing sound.
I'll let you guys decide whether you think it's Niolus, or I was going to have you roll something for it, but you guys decide if you think it's Niolus or if you think it might be something else. You guys are left in the dark, I believe, unless you have something.
Shoot, it's dark now.
I can cast light. I take out my rod and I cast light on it.
So it's
a cantrip.
You have light and Niolus. As you're making your way back, you don't experience anything in the tunnel. You make it towards the teleportation circle with the dead Zorbos and crushed Shardmind, and you can't see that anything has changed. And you take the amulet. And you mutter your incantation as you press it into a certain rune in the teleportation circle that's carved into the stone. And you feel a rush, like a pfft, and all of a sudden you're underwater and you're back home. And you look at your feet and your feet are normal. And you no longer have hillocks for feet on top of horses. And you're surrounded by guards who are guarding the teleportation circle, obviously. And they don't...
And he'll raise his hands and say, "Praised be the ocean water."
Yep. And they're not scared of you. So it leads you to believe that you're no longer a funhouse mirror. Of terror. And that's where we're going to leave it today. So thank you so much for watching episode 26 of Venture Ventures, actual play D&D show. And let's go around the table and plug what you need to plug. And we'll start with Lex.
Hi guys, I'm Lex. You can find me on Instagram at @its_Lex or on Twitter at @itbelex, or on Wednesdays I'll be playing Vi on Starfinder at Scabby Rooster on Twitch.
Cool. Dave.
Hey guys, you can just find me on the social medias at drod3. That's it.
Ryan.
You can find me on Facebook under Ryan Omega at Instagram, and or Twitter under Ryan OMGA. You could also find me my new show, Blank Slate, which is a LARP mystery black box theater type thing on Scabby Rooster, 8 p.m. Pacific time.
Cool. Richard.
You can find me at Le Richard C on everything. I am still doing the podcast, Awkward Human Survival Guide and Interview with a Nerd, so you'll be able to hear me there. And thank you for allowing me to be on this D&D stream, and I will miss you guys.
Yeah, thank you so much, Richard, for playing with us. And we had a ton of of weird encounters and just awesome weirdness. And it was a lot of fun.
If I could give you guys weird, then I did my job.
In part, you did. You were a great contributor to that. Brian.
I'm Brian, and you can't find me because I'm proficient in stealth. But really, it's just because I don't have any social media presence, and that's how I like it. I'm just here to play D&D.
You're proficient in social media stealth.
Which very. Just I have expertise in that. Yeah. Wow, I play too much D&D.
No, you don't. <That's> fantastic. Yeah, I'm Jake Friday. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Jake Friday. I believe the Instagram is at Jake.Friday. Follow Venture Ventures on Twitter at Venture Ventures and Instagram at the same. And we'll be back next week for episode 27. Again, thank you to Richard for giving us a good time for many, many months. I think it's been like 7 months. I had a great time DMing for you, Richard. And hopefully you'll write some fanfic about Niolus and what he did. Like what happened to him
what
after.
What kind of fanfic?
I just want to know what happens.
Maybe that will happen and you guys will mysteriously one day receive a letter.
That'd be so fantastic. With that, we will close the stream. Thank you so much for watching. And see you next week. Be good to others. Be good to yourself. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.